All right, let's get ready to hear the word of God from Pastor Hill. Let's say amen as he comes with the Lord to have us here in the cross and believe.
Just thank God today for His goodness and the wonderful things that He has done. Scripture says that, oh, that men would praise the Lord for His goodness. Amen. How many know God has been good? And we are to praise Him for His goodness and for His wonderful works to the children of men. All right. We just thank God for His goodness today. We got us low in numbers today. Quite a few people are observing the holidays, and we just thank God for you that's here. And I just wanted to just say a few words. Those of you that are not able to be here on Wednesday night, we want you to make sure that you get the handout that we passed out this past Wednesday night. This was focusing on the God kind of faith. And we want to begin to work on our faith and expand our believing. We want to believe for bigger things. We want to be able to hold fast to our confession, whatever we confess or whatever we believe that we receive. We want to be able to hold fast to that confession until the thing that we're believing for actually come into fruition. Amen. You know, sometimes people begin to scale back their testimony or their confession when it seems like the thing that they're believing for is not, you know, coming together. Amen. But I think that we can avoid scaling back. We can begin to add strength to our confession. Amen. And we can, amen, hold fast until the thing that we believe. The scripture says we are made partakers of Christ if we hold fast, amen, to our confession steadfast all the way to the end. Amen. So there are many components that we're studying on Wednesday night that's going to enable us to develop our faith to a level where we can see more manifestations of the things that we are believing for. Amen. Scripture says all things are possible to them that believe. Amen. All things. Not some things or no things, but all things are what? Possible to them that believe. So we want to work on our believing, expand our capability, and when we can release the things that we believe, amen, when we can release that, amen, and begin to act on what we believe, then we're going to see God do great things among us. And I just want to have a testimony or just an example from Sister Hill. She's very good in giving illustrations and examples, but she has some experiences that she wants to relate, to share with you, that will give you an idea as to what it's going to require for your faith to develop to the point where you can actually experience the manifestation. She has some real life illustrations. Not just one or two, but she has a whole bunch of them. But she's going to relate probably her favorite one. So let's receive Sister Hill as she comes. I say praise the Lord.
Saints, good morning.
Good morning.
Great. So are you happy to be here this morning?
Amen.
Some of you look kind of sad and kind of, I see some smiles. Praise God. Amen. Pastor asked me if I would do this morning. And how many of you know that I'm kind of obedient? Well, I'm obedient. Anyway, I was talking with him in terms of Wednesday night's lesson. And I believe I walked in Wednesday night when a question was being asked. And there were several responses to that. And the week before then. But the example, faith without works, that's dead. So I was telling him that a lot of times believers don't receive what they are asking God for because they don't go that extra step. I think I'll walk out here. So he says, well, why don't you give that other? I said, there has to be action. And those of you that were here Wednesday night, remember that I said there was that passive action and there was action. So I'm going to give this example in terms of relating to what I was saying. I recall, and some of you have heard me say this before, one year, Pastor and I visited our daughter when she lived in Connecticut. And it was for Christmas. And we were on our way back home. And at the airport, it was a blizzard. And when we got to the airport, there was a long line there. And I stood in the line waiting, and I thought, something is wrong. This line is too long. It's just so long. I stood in the line. Pastor was sitting somewhere reading a book. And I stood in the line to see what was going on. There were a lot of people. And I looked around, and I was the only African-American in line. And after having stood in that line for about 20 minutes, or 25 minutes, I got to the counter. And the ticket agent put a close right in front of my face. And I thought, no, he didn't do that. And my first thought was, y'all know what my first thought was. I said, I can't go there, but why did he do that to me? So I went and sat down, and I prayed, and the scriptures, this is where I'm going, the scripture came up in me. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. But I just didn't quote it. And I said, the other one, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And they began to roll in my spirit. So I said, I sat there and I thought, I'm quoting these scriptures, but I'm not doing anything. So I looked up and I saw this gentleman in white. And I saw that he worked for Continental Airlines. So I went to him and said, do you know what just happened to me? I was at that counter. I said, I think I'm going to file a discrimination complaint against Continental. He said, wait a minute. Let me check on this for you. And I was not rude. I was not ugly. I was very tactful. I didn't know at the time I was talking to the pilot of that plane that we were to fly on. And so he was very, very nice. And I was just pouring out my heart in terms of, I stood in this long line and this is what they did to me. And he says, ma'am, what's your name? I said, Marilyn Hill. He said, Miss Hill, I'll check on it for you. So he went back in there and he did something. He came back and he said, I think they're going to work out something for you. And I said, okay. And I kept sitting there and nothing happened. So eventually the ticket agent came back and he opened up again. I got in the line again. Patient. And when I finally got to the counter, he said, what we're going to do is get your hotel. And I said, where? He said, it'll be somewhere. And I looked out the window and you couldn't even see 2 feet outside. And I'm thinking, you're going to send us outside? And what he didn't know was that I had noticed that all you had to do is walk across the hall over there. And that was a big plus Sheraton Hotel right across from the airport. I don't know if you've been to the Connecticut airport. But I said to him, why do I have to go outside? Why can't I go and stay in the hotel? But it's so important to observe and listen, you all. I had seen him sending other folk over there. And when he got to me, he said, we're going to send you out. And I says, no, I would like to go over here to the Sheraton. He replied, we don't usually send people over there. I said, so you said usually that means stirring. I said, that means sometimes you do. And he said, ah, yeah, but I have to get supervisor's approval. And I said, I'll wait. I'll wait for the supervisor's approval. So I stood there. And he said, ma'am, do you mind just kind of standing aside? And I looked at him. At first I thought, no, I'm not going anywhere. But then I said, okay, I'll step aside. The example of the woman before the unjust judge came to my mind. Persistence. So I stepped aside and went back and took my seat. And I said, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. But I knew that I still had to do something. I just couldn't sit there and quote the scripture. You know, I knew. So I says, Lord, what must I do? And finally, he came back. And he said, back from me, Miss Hill. I walked to the counter, Sister Irene. And I said, yes. He said, we got you all taken care of. I said, you do? He said, yes. He had some things in his hands. He said, we're going to put you and your husband up at the Sheridan Hotel tonight. And you know, I didn't get crazy and go, oh, great, great. I just said, thank you. And he said, here are two vouchers, $15 for you, $15 for your husband for dinner tonight at the Sheridan. Thank you. And he had two more vouchers. Here are two more vouchers for your breakfast in the morning. $15 each, and I'm calculating 100 plus 30 plus 30. And then he says, then we got you booked on the first flight out of here in the morning, 8 o'clock, the first one. And you're going first class.
Wow.
I'm going, praise God. I've never flown first class. I always fly coach. But first class, I still maintain my composure. I said, thank you, Lord. And I said, thank you to him. I said, thank you. I didn't get crazy. But I sat there and thought, what if I, when he closed that thing in my face, I had just gone and sat and quoted the scripture and didn't do anything? What would have happened? Y'all tell me, what would have happened?
Nothing.
What if when I went back up to him and asked him about the hotel, he said, we don't usually put people up in there. And if I had accepted, and if I didn't insist on, I want to be at the Sheridan, where would I have been? Somewhere else out in the snow, in the blizzard. So what I'm saying is, that's what I was telling Pastor the other night. Yes, you got to quote the scripture. Yes, you internalize it. But when you are in a situation, that's when and quoting the scripture, establishing your belief, and all, that is some form of action. But it takes action to get something done. Remember the woman before the unjust judge? She went back. He told her no. She left, went back again, no. And finally, he got sick of her, and he gave her what she wanted. That was action. So I was telling Pastor, there has to be some action, and so many times we fall short because we just get tired. I heard Sister Denise say the other night, a lot of times we don't get what we want because we're lazy. And I had to ponder that for a minute. But I said, she's right. A lot of times we're too lazy to get up off our seat. We're too lazy to push to get what we want. And when we come to Bible study, when we read, when we pray, and when we meditate, it should be with the purpose of, firstly, I want to please you, God. And secondly, then what your promises that you have made to me, I want those to become real in my life. I want them to materialize. How do I get that to materialize in my life? I must do something. Do something. I don't think I can overemphasize that. Do something. One other example, just one other, Pastor. Okay. And I was had visited my friend in California, and I flew on a ticket that my son-in-law had bought for me. barren. And it was in, I think his name. Okay, yeah, I believe it was in his name. So that was before 9/11 and all this. So when I got to the counter, the lady said, let me see your ID. And I really didn't have it. I had not thinking, put it in my luggage. I said, I don't have it. So she said, you can't fly on this plane unless you have your ID. And I said, ma'am, you don't understand. I've got to get back. I live in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I've got to get back to Tulsa today. And she said, well, you can buy another ticket. I said, how much does another ticket cost? She said, $400. I said, I can't pay that kind of money. When I already have a round trip ticket, she said, but you can't fly. And people were standing behind me, and it was about 15 minutes before the plane was to depart. I knew I couldn't hold up the line. So I said, Lord, what must I do? And the Lord told me to just step out of line. And I did that. I stepped out of line, and I literally did this, and put my face to the wall and prayed. And I said, Lord, I've got to get back to Tulsa. I was by myself, Pastor wasn't with me. What must I do? And it just like that, it came to me. Near the end of that line, just before the flight boards, you go back and get in the end of that line and stand in there, which is what I did. I went back up to the counter, and that lady said, weren't you just in this line? I said, yes, ma'am, I was, but I'm here again. And she said, where is your ID? And I said, it's in my luggage. She said, you should never do that. I said, I know now, but I'm telling you, that's where it is, and I've got to get home. She said, well, what is the address? And I remember Kim's address, gave her the address. What's the phone number? Gave her the phone number. And she looked at me, Sister Khalila. She said, I'm going to clear you to get on this flight. And boy, I was praising God on the inside. And I was flying from LA to Houston. And she said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to even clear you for Houston so you won't have to go through this again. And I says, praise the Lord God. I thank you, Jesus. What did I do? I persisted. I took action. When I got out of line, I could have just gone and said, well, I don't know what I'm going to do. I could have called my friend and said, come pick me up because I can't fly. But no, I prayed. And I says, God, you know. You know, give me directions as to what to do. And yes, scriptures began to come up in my spirit. And that's where, as pastors say, the belief comes. You got to put something in if you want to draw something out. And the Lord just showed me what to do. Now, what the net results was, I got home on time. I got on that flight with, they had earlier told me, you cannot get on it. But I didn't give up. And then they said, you're going to have to pay $400-some dollars. And no way am I going to play when I have a round trip ticket. Oh, no. And so sometimes you have to have tenacious faith, Sister Wayne. Push. Push. And sometimes when people tell you no, you might be talking to the wrong person. You may have to go to somebody else. But in both of those instances, I went back to the same person. I went back to the same person. I persisted. And one of the things that I always do, you don't get ugly, loud, and wrong. Because if you do that, you turn people off. But persist. And the word, all of you have the word deep down within you. And when you're in those situations, use what you know. Just don't use it in Bible study. And just don't hear it on Sunday morning. Every week, every day, I submit to you, you encounter some situations in which you need to use the word. And I say, persist. Don't give up. And don't give in. If you know you're doing the right thing, and use the word, take action. Take action. Take action. Take action. Praise God.
Brother Mariko can do that. You can do it on the spot. Just come here just for a second. Just answer a question. All right. He used to be a little shy. You had to let him know a week or two ahead. But Jessica, and you know, many of you have the same type testimony of how God placed a vision in his heart. The word was really strongly. He began, you know, he believed the word, but yet there were things that he had to act on in order to make the promises of God real. And y'all know the story when he got saved, and Jessica was already established in the Lord. So I guess she kind of worked on it spiritually, got him to a point where he was ready to completely surrender, but he was really faithful when he really came into the ministry. Very faithful, very diligent, consistent, and got filled with the Holy Ghost. And it seems like he always was concerned about missing God or doing something wrong. So obedience was a big thing. Now he'll tell you about, you know, how much value and importance he placed on time, even to the extent where many times they didn't have things that they needed personally when they first started out, but they put those time in front of everything. And then how God just began to continue to lead them and direct them. But they had to take what? Action after action after action. Although faith was alive in their heart, but they still had to act on what they had in their heart and what they were believing. And he can just tell you some of the things that he has encountered just by acting, just stepping out. He didn't always know the end result, but he just stepped out on God's word because the word was in his heart. All right, he's going to tell you whatever the Lord, amen. This is by faith today.
This is by faith. Let me see where I start. Oh, by the way, I had a rough week this week. My grandfather we had to place him into the nursing home this week, and I thought I was going to lose him. So that's been heavy on my mind. So I'm going to try to think of you know, all the things that God has done for us. When I first got saved, God just opened up doors. I'm not saying I didn't believe in God, but I've always been the type of person that if I say I'm going to do something, I try to do the best I can do to make it happen. And before I got saved, I was doing all these things and it just wasn't working. So when I got saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, all the things that I learned from my grandfather, I started putting those things to use. Like Cecile said, you know, get off my bottom and make it really happen. And I'm sorry, I'm trying to think here. So God just opened up doors. He helped me, you know, the Holy Spirit just helped me, you know, capitalize on the things that I already knew. And, you know, to make a long story short, I just, you know, you can't be lazy, bottom line. You know, if you know the word and you know what you're supposed to do, you just got to do it. Sometimes it's painful. Sometimes, you know, you don't feel like going. A quick deal here. See, about 5 years ago, maybe 6 years ago, somebody told me to go out to Garden Ridge and bid on the account. And it was about they told me I had to be there at 5:30 in the morning. And I told my wife, man, I don't want to go do this. So I almost overslept. She woke me up and said, you know, don't you need to go out to Garden Ridge? She said, I think you should go. So when I went out there, I met this guy named Robert, and he's one of the guys. His company was huge. I mean, he's about my age, and he was doing big things. So when I went out there, he had already won the bid. And so when I was ready to walk off, he said, hey, are you here for the account? I said, yeah. He said, I'm sorry, but my company already got it. I said, okay, congratulations. Then me and him started talking, and you know, and he looked over at me and said, you know what? I don't have any friends. I was like, I was thinking, what are you telling me for? But I said, okay, I